Can't get the slide to change. Hold on. Oh, here are six. So I've introduced all this apparatus to do with subject matter and truth makers and false makers. And now I propose to just sort of look in a somewhat kind of scattershot fashion at a few paradoxes and puzzles that subject matter theory might or might not be helpful with. I'm not going to say anything deeply satisfying, but hope to say some things that are slightly kind of titillating on the relevance of truth makers to paradox. So we'll start with the Sorites. So first, a notion that I didn't explain before, a couple theoretical slides. What is a subject matter? Well, this probably isn't the final definition we want to give. It's the definition that I used in the book Aboutness, various refinements due to Kit Fine. Would be helpful in connection with some of these examples. But for now, it's simplest to just think of a subject matter as a relation on possible worlds. You've got all the possible worlds. At MIT, they say, oh, you have logical space. You draw a picture and you say it's not actual size or something like that. It's not to scale. And you group worlds together according to whether the worlds are just alike where the subject matter intuitively conceived is concerned. So the number of stars is Lewis's example. That's a way of dividing up worlds so that worlds with equally many stars go into the same bucket. That's a subject matter that's an equivalence relation on worlds. There might be other ones that are weaker relations, like similarity relations, like say visual indiscernibility. It could be that world one is visually indiscernible from world two, and two from three, and three from four, but you can distinguish one from four, in which case the subject matter wouldn't be a transitive relation. It would be it would just be a similarity relation, not an equivalence relation. But we'll come to some examples in a minute. So just suppose subject matter. A subject matter corresponds roughly to, if you take almost any question, and then you turn it into a so-called indirect question, like, what did you do last summer would be a direct question. The question would be, what you did last summer. According to what you did last summer. So worlds are in the same cell, just if you did the very same things in those worlds. As I say it here, they're grouped together if they're just alike where the subject matter is concerned. You can think of it oftentimes as an equivalence relation, but sometimes, importantly, it'll be a similarity relation. Sometimes it'll be even weaker than that. I don't think I'm going to need more than similarity. Now, here's an important notion that I'm not sure I ever introduced. We talked a lot about sentential subject matter, the subject matter of a particular sentence, but let's just talk about free-floating subject matters, like, say, the number of stars or where the Pope lives or something like that. So a sentence is true about a subject matter in a world if it's true outright, true period, in another world that's just like the first where that subject matter is concerned. Another way to put it is, there's nothing in W's, there might be something in W that makes the sentence S false, but there's nothing in the world W's M condition. There's nothing in the way things stand M-wise to make the sentence false. So S might as well have been true in W, attending only to the features that M cares about. And so you've got a world, the blue world W and the other blue world W prime, they're M alike. We want to say S is true, read that subject matter in W because it's true outright in W prime, which is just like W or M is concerned. So that shows the fact that there's a world just like W where M is concerned. Sorry about that. The fact that there's a world just like W where M is concerned. And the sentence is true outright shows that it wasn't W's M condition that was getting in the way of the truth. So S was happy. S gets W right where M is concerned, or as far as M is concerned, or in M-ish respects. And if you think about it, the way I've explained truth about M, it's really like a modal operator. It's a diamond operator, one for each subject matter. Possibly MS holds, say actually, if and only if S could be true, holding fixed the world's M condition. You can think of the M condition as just sort of the set of worlds like our world in M respects, or which for Lewis, a set of worlds is a proposition. So it's sort of that set of worlds is the proposition that says how things stand M-wise. So in the case, if there's like, I just read there was a map of the Milky Way that was recently put together that had 2 billion separate stars in the Milky Way alone. So take the number of stars again. The number of stars divides worlds up according to how many stars are in them. So the cell that the actual world belongs to is going to contain, let's suppose that there's really like 10 billion stars overall, the Milky Way stars and all the other stars. I know that's preposterous. Well, the set of all worlds with 10 billion stars just is the proposition that there are 10 billion stars. So the actual world's number of stars condition just is there are 10 billion of them, something like that, on that assumption. But the point is it's a diamond operator. You're sort of saying, yeah, it may not be true, but you could make it true while leaving everything M-ish exactly the same. Now, a separate notion. Again, this is not about sentential subject matter itself. I'll bring that in a second. It's another relation between a sentence and a subject matter. Well, actually, the first thing wasn't a relation. It was just this notion of truth about a subject matter in a world. This is just a relation between sentences and subject matter. A sentence is wholly about a subject matter, M. This is Lewis's definition. If and only if its truth value never varies between worlds that are M alike. So if two worlds are just alike M-wise, then the sentence will be true in both of them or false in both of them. And here's an important, so for instance, the number of stars is prime is wholly about the number of stars. Because if there's two worlds with equally many stars, then one of them makes it true that the number of stars is prime, then the other one is also going to make it true that the number of stars is prime. But if I say there are more stars than planets, that's not wholly about the number of stars, because there could be two worlds with equally many stars, but one has more planets than the other, such that, I can't remember what the sentence was, but such that now the planets outnumber the stars, or the stars outnumber the planets, or whatever, where they didn't before. That shows that the truth value of the sentence doesn't supervene on which cell of the number of stars that subject matter you're in. And so the sentence, there are more stars than planets, or there are more planets than stars, those sentences are not wholly about the subject matter, the number of stars, because there's something that can vary between worlds that isn't sort of, doesn't factor into that subject matter, but still relevant to the truth values of the sentences. Okay, now here's an important observation. If a sentence is wholly about a subject matter, in other words, its truth doesn't depend on anything not contemplated in that subject matter, it's about nothing else but that subject matter, then the sentence is true outright, if and only if it's true about that subject matter. So the number of stars is prime, is true outright if and only if it's true about the subject matter, number of stars. But the number of stars exceeds the number of planets, since it's not wholly about the number of stars. The fact that it's, well, let's just suppose it is true about the number of stars, because you could keep the number of stars the same and destroy all the planets, and then the stars would outnumber the planets, so the sentence would change truth value. That sentence is not true outright if and only if it's true about the number of stars, because there could in fact be fewer stars than planets, so the sentence is false. But you could turn our world into a world where there's more stars than planets without mucking with the world's M condition, with its number of planets condition. So if a sentence is wholly about a subject matter, which I kind of put colloquially as it's about nothing else there's besides that subject matter, isn't to say it's about all of that subject matter, then the sentence is true outright if and only if it's true about that subject matter. But if a sentence is not wholly about a subject matter, then it could be true about the subject matter but false outright. So I've used this notion of being wholly about a subject matter. If you think about it, the notion of being wholly about a subject matter is upwards monotonic. If a sentence is wholly about one subject matter, a certain way of divvying up worlds, then it's going to be wholly about any larger subject matter, one which divides logical space up more finely. So for instance, you can take the subject matter, the maximal subject matter is what everything is like in every respect. Each world gets its own cell. Well, every sentence is wholly about that subject matter. Sentences never change truth value between worlds in a given cell because there never are two worlds in a given cell for them to change truth value between. But clearly, that's much too big to count as the subject matter of a sentence. It would give every sentence the same subject matter. So being wholly about a subject matter is interesting, but it doesn't really give you a unique sentential subject matter. The way to get a unique sentential subject matter is you want to add to this thing about nothing else but M. You want to add about all of M. In other words, every distinction that M cares about, S cares about too. It can affect how S is true or false. And so that's why sentential subject matters are the special case where worlds are grouped according to how S is true or false in them. And so if we use small s as the subject matter of sentence S, small typewriter S, S is both wholly about that subject matter, it's about nothing else, and it's also exactly about it. It's about all of that subject matter and about nothing else. That's what I call exactly about. Now, here's where we're starting to get near paradoxes. Sometimes, one could argue, it's part of a sentence's intended meaning, the thing you're supposed to know if you understand the sentence, that it should be wholly about a certain subject matter M. So someone might think, well, this is a bad example, but you might argue, should moral evaluations concern only what the agent does deliberately? Well, if you're a Kantian, you might think so. That's why moral luck is interesting. Sometimes you evaluate people more harshly if they do something that has a really bad result. Maybe they were being reckless, but recklessness isn't as bad if no one gets hurt as if someone gets hurt. And then people say, oh, look, you're confusing right and wrong with praiseworthiness and blameworthiness and so on and so forth. You just heard all I know about ethics. Okay. Now, here's something that many people, especially in earlier writings about the Sorites paradox, would say. Crispin Wright says this a lot. Dummett says it a lot. Color talk about what's red, say, is supposed to be wholly about a certain subject matter, which I call, following Lewis, observation. The way, what Crispin Wright says is, it's a deep fact about the sense of the word red, that it's an observational predicate that's supposed to be applicable solely on the basis of casual observation. And I'm sort of reinterpreting that as Red Talk is supposed to be about, wholly about observation, which is the subject matter that groups worlds together if we can't, by casual inspection, tell them apart. Of course, what does this even mean? Are we allowed to, So I, you know, we can talk about what it could mean later. I argue in my aboutness book that this is really the notion that von Frassen should have used when he was developing constructive empiricism, because he says, you know, a theory is empirically adequate if it's true about observables or something like that. But of course, observables have lots of properties that aren't accessible to observation. And you wouldn't, an empirically adequate theory, you know, dirt is observable, but an empirically adequate theory shouldn't have to get the subatomic structure of dirt right. So better to let the thing that an empirically adequate theory needs to be true about, let it be observation, not a part of the world, but a subject matter, a way of grouping worlds. I'm sure what I just said is not very relevant. I mean, you know, to anything about Frassen actually says. So anyway, you know, I got good to hear more. Yeah, I'm sorry. Here's the right quote. Color predicates are purely observational. It's a very fundamental fact about their sentences whose sacrifice would be possible only at great cost. And you can think of other kinds of, there are principles with this nature that where they're almost like regulative ideals for like how we're supposed to understand the word. If you give this up, then it doesn't really make any sense to us. It loses its raison d'etre. It's so if you think about truth, you know, Tarski and biconditionals seem like this. You know, if you give up Tarski and biconditionals, then it just seems like you're giving up truth. That's just what it's supposed to be like. The example I sometimes use is, you know, suppose someone comes up with a, let me not bother about that. So consider a Sorites argument whose key premises are of the form PI, then PI plus one, which is short for XI is red, then XI plus one is red. Okay. And of course, another premise is X naught is red. And another premise is XN is not red. Say it's orange. So since those last two premises I mentioned, the first thing in the sequence is red and the last thing is orange, not red, no one's ever thought to deny them. One of these conditionals has got to be false. They can't all be true. But there's a way in which, kind of like a bad relationship, you can't give them up. You can't abandon them. They seem true in an especially forceful way, in the same way that T biconditionals seem true. They seem like part of what we had in mind all along and without which we wouldn't know what we were doing with these predicates. So why do these sentences seem true? Well, each of them is true about observation. Because the way if the Sorites sequence is set up properly, if you just look at two adjoining paint chips in the sequence, you can't distinguish them color-wise. They look to be the same color, or anyway, they don't look to be different colors. They look as though one is red if and only if the other one is red, because red is supposed to supervene on how things look. But how, in the terms of our theory, does it fall from that each is true about observation? Well, in fact, P2 is a little bit less red than P1, say. So why do I say P1 then P2 is true about observation? Well, remember how true about observation was defined. P1 then P2 is true about observation. If there's a world observationally indistinguishable from ours, where the two items are the exact same color, But given that we can't tell them apart, presumably there's a world that looks just like ours, where they look just the same, and they really are the exact same color. So it's true about observation that if the one is true, then the other is true. Indeed, it's true about observation that they're the same color. In other words, we can't distinguish our world observationally from a world where that premise is really true. And that holds for each of the controversial premises. Well, you might think, okay, but that doesn't really gain us anything, because you've now got each of these premises is true about observation. But the conclusion, if you run the argument as a reductio, is the absurd. Or you could let it be, the conclusion could be the last item in the series is red and not red. But that's not true about observation. There's no world observationally equivalent to ours where something is red and not red. So you've got a valid argument from premises that are true about observation to a conclusion that's false about observation. That's bad. But here's the kicker. Truth-preservingness is a feature of valid arguments. Truth about a subject matter preservingness is not a feature of valid arguments. Because, remember I said a minute ago, truth about a subject matter is really like a hidden modal operator. It's a hidden possibility operator. So if you take a valid argument, say A, B, then C, and you say the premises are true about M, so the conclusion should be, that's like reasoning possibly A, let the argument be A, B, therefore A and B. That's like reasoning possibly A, possibly B, therefore possibly A and B. But of course, that's not valid. The diamond operator means that there's, another way of thinking of it is there's a hidden existential quantifier in each premise. There is a world where, suitably related to our world, where the premise is true. But it needn't be the same world in every case. And indeed, there's no single world where all those premises, observationally indistinguishable from ours, where all those premises are simultaneously true. So the argument turns out to be, it's a valid argument, but the features of the premises that make us think they're true is a feature that isn't preserved by valid arguments because it has a hidden existential quantifier in it. So the premises, but still, we can't simply say, oh, well, then the problem goes away, because the premises truth where their intended subject matter is concerned, namely observation, makes them seem true outright. Indeed, it sort of has to make them seem true outright. I mean, even now, knowing as we do about Sorites' paradoxes, it just does seem like a feature of at least a relatively molar color term like red, that it's observational. Otherwise, people would sort of give you a fight. Say, how can you tell? You just looked at it. I said, actually, you know, some people, it happens a lot in my family, I look at things and I pronounce their color, and people do argue with me about it, and I am wrong. But so even though I want to say that it gets us out of the problem that truth about observation is not preserved by valid argumentation, in another way, it doesn't, because truth about observation is supposed to be sufficient for truth outright, because those premises are all supposed to be about observation. So let me. Oops. So let me spell this out a bit more. Some of you might know this paper of Chalmers on color properties, where he talks about Edenic color properties, the kind of color properties we imagine we were confronting back in Eden. And they've got all sorts of special properties. They're simple, they're primitive, they're dissective, and so on. Okay. I said red talk is supposed to be wholly about observation, but this leads to contradiction in a world with Sorites sequences. So you might ask, how did we wind up imposing, if you like, analytically or aspirationally analytically, an unworkable subject matter? Well, it seemed like a really good idea at the time because there weren't any Sorites sequences, let's suppose, back in Eden where the word was introduced. It was actually hard for me to find a picture of Eden that didn't have any Sorites looking sequences in it. This is the best I could do. Let's just suppose, you know, things grouped up, clumped up naturally into colors, which is sort of like what a kid might suppose. It's a bit of a discovery that there are these sequences of tiny changes. So the premises, I would argue, would have been analytic if, in fact, in the world at large, objects clumped up color-wise like they did in Eden. Maybe we could even suppose, I mean, this would be definitely true if objects were sort of bound to clump up color-wise. But even if, in fact, in the world, objects do clump up color-wise, then we probably would have regarded it as analytic, that if two things are observationally indistinguishable, then one is right if and only if the other one is right. So I might think of it might be a thought experiment that might lead us to question that, but we might just sort of say, as my colleague Augustine Rayo does say about a bunch of these paradoxes, that, well, you know, the concept presupposes that that doesn't happen. So not only would the premises have been analytic if objects had clumped up the way they should have, and the way they almost always really do when you're out on the street, observationality still gives the predicates their point and purpose. We still almost never run into Sorites sequences. To question these predicates defeats the predicate's whole point and purpose. So here's like a really dumb analogy. So back in Eden, we coined the word perfect because, well, we believed in God, and God was something that could not be improved upon. So it made sense to have a word perfect that only applied if a thing was as good as possible. Well, now, let's say, we don't believe there's something that's as good as possible. We still want to use the word. So we now say things like, it was a perfect day. Thank you. That was a perfect day. Now, of course, any day could have been a little bit better. There could have been one more bluebird twittering in the trees. But to add to it was a perfect day, it could have been better, just sounds analytically false because it defeats the whole point of perfect talk. So sometimes you retain the talk and retain as a regulative ideal whatever the principles were that gave that talk its point and purpose in the first place. But as Kant himself says, I shouldn't say himself, I mean, as the other, everyone's talking about regulative ideals. Regulative ideals are supposed to sort of guide us and make towards sort of destinations that may not really exist, but you can always improve your conduct by paying closer attention to the regulative idea. Now, consider Tarski and biconditionals. Now, this one kind of depends on your knowing a bit about Tarski's theory of truth. I mean, Kripke's theory of truth. I'll say a little bit about that on the way. So consider Tarski and biconditionals, T phi, if and only if phi. Here's a natural thought. So somebody came up with these really clever ungroundedness-making expressive devices. This was long after Eden, according to some, it was Eubulides and the pre-Socratic, he was a contemporary of Plato, maybe, who thought of this very sentence is false. And then Kripke refers to what's the greatest introduction to a philosophy paper ever is how Kripke begins Outline of a Theory of Truth, where he says, since Pilate asked, what is truth? The search for an answer has been inhibited by a problem that also arises in an Old Testament, a New Testament context, which was St. Paul saying of Cretans that all Cretans, sorry, St. Paul's, I don't know, I'm forgetting how it goes. A Cretan says, or St. Paul encounters a Cretan who says, don't believe Cretans, all Cretans are liars. So let's think of these kinds of sentences as relatively sophisticated developments, later developments in the kind of construction of a language as self-referential devices are added in, or more generally ungroundedness making expressive devices are added in. So back in Eden, there were no such devices. It made sense to take the full subject matter of truth talk, to be grounded truth, where grounded truth is the kind of truth that supervenes on the non-semantic facts, just sort of the fives with no T's in them. And it made sense, therefore, to take sentences to be true, full stop, just if they were true about this subject matter, grounded truth. So what is this subject matter, grounded truth, if you think of subject matters in the way I've been suggesting, as similarity relations, or in this case, it'll be equivalence relations on worlds? Well, let worlds be Kripkean fixed points. A Kripkean fixed point is a model just start with the regular first letter language and enhance it with a truth predicate, which is assigned some extension. It may be an incomplete extension. The extension might be is disjoint from the anti-extension. There might be things that are in neither. Sorry, I just realized I've got a... And this model makes T phi true, phi is true, true. Just, I mean, it satisfies phi is true, if and only if it satisfies phi. So it satisfies snow is white is true, if and only if it satisfies snow is white. That's what a Kripkean fixed point is. Most of the attention has gone to the smallest Kripkean fixed point, which leaves almost all the problematic sentences you might worry about, like the liar sentence or the truth teller, undefined. In other words, the truth teller, this very sentence is true, isn't put into the extension of T or the anti-extension of T. But it remains true that the model verifies, say the truth teller or the liar, is true if and only if the model verifies the teller or the liar, because it verifies neither. So grounded truth is the subject matter that groups worlds together which agree on the values assigned to sentences without the truth predicate. In other words, they share what's sometimes called the ground model or the underlying model, the model of the T-free part of the language. So here's what's interesting. We're interested in which sentences are not true outright, but true about this particular subject matter of grounded truth. Turns out that every Tarskian T by conditional, T phi if and only if phi, whether it's true outright or not, is always true about this subject matter of grounded truth. So if we were confused about whether we were talking about everything or talking about grounded truth as we had meant to be when we introduced the truth predicate, because it all was supposed to flow up from the ground, if we were confused about that, and we confused being true outright with being true about the intended subject matter of grounded truth, then of course the Tarskian biconditionals would strike us as true. Because they are true, and actually whatever world you go to, it's similar to a world where that sentence is true. Why? Well, take any fixed point world you like. The M equivalent world to it is the so-called dual of the minimal fixed point. Basically, you go to the minimal fixed point, you turn all the gaps into gluts, both true and false. And then T phi if and only if phi will be true. Okay. And don't say, oh, well, T phi if and only if not phi will also be true. That is the case for the liar sentence. And it even is the case for the truth teller sentence. But it isn't the case for snow is white. T phi if and only if sentences that only get a single truth value in the minimal fixed point only get a single truth value in the maximal fixed point as well. And so T phi if and only if phi sort of is you know, stands above the crowd as a sentence that's necessarily bound to be true in some fixed point, just like the actual, whatever fixed point you're in, where the ground facts are concerned. People can ask questions about that later, obviously. Okay, paradox of the ravens. Nico condition. A generalization. All Fs are Gs is confirmed by each of its instances. Equivalence condition. I'm sorry, I'm just rushing you through a bunch of different examples. I'm hoping that some of you, you know, most of you will have heard of most of them. Equivalence condition. If two hypotheses are logically equivalent, they're confirmed by the same evidence. Equivalence fact. All ravens are black is logically equivalent to all non-black things are non-ravens. And then paradoxical conclusion, all ravens are black is confirmed by non-black, non-ravens, e.g. a white piece of paper. Why? Because all ravens are black is logically equivalent to all non-black things are non-ravens, and the non-black, non-raven that a white piece of paper is confirms that generalization by the Nico condition. The paradox mongering gloss that people sometimes put on this is, my watch just found the article on the Raven paradox, so I'm going to let the watch give the rest of it. Okay, the paradox mongering gloss is indoor in ornithology is possible. So here's some standard responses, except the paradoxical conclusion. It's not really that paradoxical. This is what Hempel says. Bayesians say, I can't remember why I say that Goodman says it, deny the Nico's condition. Generalizations are not always confirmed by their instances. So Quine says only when generalizations are framed in terms of natural kinds. I.J. Good gives a counterexample, which I don't find very, very convincing. Deny the equivalence condition. Logically equivalent hypotheses need not be conformationally equivalent. Or deny the equivalence fact. Contrapositive generalizations aren't always logically equivalent. So then here's a different response, which is, I call it new, but it's really the response given by Ken Jeans in some really interesting work in the early 90s that in some as part of the prehistory of all this subject matter and logical part stuff. The argument is invalid due to committing a fallacy of equivocation. Logically equivalent hypotheses are conformationally equivalent in one sense, but the paradoxical conclusion is paradoxical only for a different sort of conformation. So now I've got to distinguish those. Two kinds of, and this is a really old distinction that used to be very popular with the rise of Bayesianism. People stopped talking about it. But it's the distinction that, Goodman drew it already. Gretzky talks about it. Many people have talked about it. It's between simple conformation and so-called inductive conformation. So E simply confirms H if the probability of H on E exceeds the probability of H. And as I pointed out last time, simple or two times ago, simple conformation is actually trivial when H implies E. If H implies E, then E automatically pretty much simply confirms H. But this has the result that, say, I am Steve Yablo. That simply confirms everyone is Steve Yablo, because the one entails the other. And it's just a basic fact about probability relations that they respect logical relations. Here's the second definition. I mean, this is not really, I'm not saying that this is news to any Bayesians, I should quickly add. Here's the second definition. E inductively confirms H, if and only if. It's not just that E probabilifies H. E probabilifies H and all of its parts, all of its content parts. So for all K, I'm using the kind of stylized less than or equal to thing here for parthood, because I'm using just regular angle brackets for greater than among real numbers. For all K, part of H, the probability of K given E exceeds the probability of K. Or maybe it could be like weak dominance, you know. Sometimes it properly exceeds it, sometimes it's equal. Now, this is really non-trivial because E has also got to probabilify the rest of H, what H adds to E. That's how Goodman puts it. This raven should not just confirm all ravens are black in the way that the coin came up heads confirms the coin will come up heads all day. It should actually confirm that the next raven we see is going to be black in the way that this coin coming up heads doesn't confirm, let's suppose, that the next time we flip it, it'll come up heads. So I am Steve Yablo doesn't inductively confirm that everyone is Steve Yablo. In fact, it refutes it, given that there are other people. So logical equivalents do agree in what simply confirms them, but I want to say they don't agree in what inductively confirms them, since logical equivalents sometimes have different truth makers and hence different parts. And if you assume, which is actually a little bit tricky to arrange, but if you assume that instances of a generalization are parts, there's somewhat of a tangle about what an instance of a generalization really is. And it's not obvious there's a good way to explain what it is with ordinary logical resources. So we could come back to that if you want. But let's just assume that that's somehow arranged. All ravens are black has as a part, Rudy the raven is black. But it's not part of all ravens are black that Ray the non-black thing is a non-raven. Certainly, if Ray the non-black thing was a raven, it would be false that all ravens are black. What you have in Ray the non-black thing is a non-raven is dodging a bullet rather than a part of what is being said. The fact that something is capable of being falsified by blah and then that blah doesn't happen is confirmationally interesting, but it isn't getting at a part of what was said by the original thing. When I say it's going to be sunny all day, I'm not saying all potential counterexamples turn out to be spurious. Even though if one turns out not to be spurious, I'm in trouble. So here's the circle of life as I understand it. So start on the left-hand side. So take all ravens are black and all non-black things are non-ravens. There's truth maker differences here. What makes it true that Rudy and all the other ravens are black? What makes it true that all ravens are black is that Rudy is black and various other things are black, which are the rest of the ravens. What makes it true that all non-black things are non-ravens is that Ray, let's say she's a white piece of paper, is non-ravenous. And everything else that's non-black is non-ravenous. This difference in truth makers makes for myriological logical differences. So all ravens are black contains Rudy is black. All non-black things are non-ravenous contains Ray is non-ravenous, but not the other way around. I guess maybe I should say non-ravenous, but that means something else. That makes for the difference, the myriological differences between these contrapositive generalizations make for inductive differences because probabilifying, they differ in their parts. Probabilifying the one's parts is different from probabilifying the other parts. Probabilifying Rudy is black is different from probabilifying Ray is non-ravenous. Oh, I really should have started with topical differences. That's what I should have started. The arrows were a bit of a clue there. What I should have said to begin with was, well, look, all ravens are black. And this is something that Hempel says himself. It's about ravens. All non-black things are non-ravens is about non-black things. So there's an intuitive subject matter difference. One is how ravens are colored versus how non-black things are typed taxonomically. Then that leads to the truth maker differences. That leads to the myriological differences, and then that leads to the inductive differences if inductive confirmation is a matter of probabilifying a thing and its part. So it's because contrapositives differ in their parts that there is a sense of confirmation. So that even despite being logically equivalent, they're not equiconfirmed, because they're not, their parts aren't equiconfirmed. Okay. Let's see, it's 11:53. We started a little bit late. Mateo, how long do you think I should go? Oh, sure, I'll definitely get through that. Okay. So here's something that we all know. Your belief that P does not constitute knowledge, well, there's two different, importantly different kinds of cases. So start with the one on the right. There's some non-actual false maker for P. Let's suppose P is true. Like, there really is a zebra in the pen. Here's a non-actual false maker. There's only a painted donkey in the pen. If there's an unactual false maker of perhaps of a particularly salient type to P, then I don't count as knowing that P if I don't have something to say against that non-actual false maker, or unless maybe I'm entitled to assume it's a crazy non-actual false maker or something like that. I've got to be somehow defended against the non-actual false makers. So I call those Dretzky cases. I've got to be able to rule out at least relevant alternatives. Relevant alternatives are, we can think of them for these purposes as close enough to non-actual false makers. But another way that a belief that P can fail to constitute knowledge is that the belief is true, again, but it's overly invested or tied to or predicated on the wrong truth maker, not the actual truth maker, but some non-actual truth maker that one takes to obtain, but doesn't really. So again, to give the famous example, one doesn't know there are barns around here. If one believes it on the basis that this thing is a barn, where this thing is really just a facade. So the two standard ways in which a belief can fail to constitute knowledge is that you're defenseless against the non-actual false maker, or you're attracted to a non-actual truth maker. Now let me apply that to a couple of paradoxes. So Kripke's dogmatism paradox, which, yeah. So what Kripke points out is, suppose, I'm pretty sure I turned the oven off when I left the house. I remember doing it. But if by misleading evidence, we mean evidence against the truth, then it follows from A, that whatever evidence may exist against A is misleading, because it follows from A that A is true, and therefore, whatever evidence may exist against A is evidence against the truth. But although I feel pretty sure that I turned the oven off, I don't feel sure that whatever evidence may exist against A is misleading. I'm reluctant to assert that. Here's one explanation of why that might be. I believe that B is much more Gettyizable, because I have no idea what evidence may exist, or hence which truth maker obtains. So maybe I think that the evidence is the testimony of these 10 people 1 to 10. And I think the first three people said that I didn't turn the oven off, and the other ones said I did turn it off. Then I might be content to say whatever evidence may exist is misleading, because I think the first three are wrong. But then suppose it turns out that actually four people said I turned the oven off, or maybe two people said that I didn't turn it off, or two people said it, or three people and a parrot did, or something else did. I'm very unsure of my ground here. I don't know my way around B B's subject matter as well as I do around A. So I'm inclined to think if you infer B from A without thinking for a moment about whatever evidence might exist or being drawn to a particular hypothesis about what evidence exists, it might be that you could know B on the basis of A. But the usual way of believing B involves forming some conjecture about what evidence may exist. And say, look, if the house is on fire, that's not misleading evidence against my turning the stove off. So I better say that the house hasn't caught fire since I left. But do I know the house hasn't caught fire? I mean, it's kind of like, do I still know the car is parked out inside of my office? It hasn't been stolen? So that's one thing you could say about Kripke's dogmatism paradox. Here's Makinson's paradox of the preface. Suppose that I write a book, it has 100 sentences, P1, P2, etc. I'm sure of each sentence. I know each sentence. I know P1, I know P2. I also know that these are the contents, these sentences together form my book. This is the contents of my book. But this entails that I allowed no errors into my book. I didn't make any errors in writing my book. It seems like I don't believe that I didn't. I'm much less confident that I didn't make any errors in writing my book. Why would that be? Well, the reason could be similar to what we said about the Kripke paradox, except on the false maker side. B has different false makers. So if I say I allowed no errors into writing my book, no errors into my book, someone could say, not even the sentence you wrote when you were sort of totally drunk that night and you couldn't like add two and two. Well, I'm not so well defended against that. Just generally, there's lots of facts in the world that I might not remember right now that could have some claim to, sorry, shouldn't say facts, but some hypotheses that have some claim to plausibility, but that actually would be false makers for B. So I'm less on top of the subject matter of B than I am of A. I'm better defended against the old false makers than against the new ones. Okay. Well, there's more going on in the preface paradox than failure to know or believe that I allowed no errors into my book, because I probably, or I may, positively disbelieve that no errors have crept in. And this gets us a bit closer to the problem of logical omniscience, which I want to understand not just as the problem of how to make excuses for our bad logical behavior, but trying to make rational sense of our conduct in cases where we don't, where our beliefs don't seem to hang logically together. I want to say, look, that's not intrinsically any different than having desires that are in conflict. You've just got to, it presents you with a predicament. You've got to work out which desire you're going to hold on to and which you're going to sort of give up or at least tolerate its frustration. But it's part of ordinary human functioning that not only that you shouldn't draw conclusions that are available to be drawn, but that even you draw conclusions that are the negations of what you should have drawn. So I'm going to start with the sins of omission and then come to sins of commission at the end. So here's a famous example from a paper by Larry Powers called Knowledge by Deduction. Suppose I ask you, are there six-letter words ending in MT, six-letter English words? And you think about it for a while, you might think of one or you might not. The answer is, but many people will say, I said the first time around, I don't know, I haven't had enough time to think about it. Well, you were aware all along that dreamt was such a word. I mean, you always knew, didn't you, that dreamt was a word of English, and you're under no illusions about how many letters it contained. I mean, I didn't even have to include the six. I could say, are there words ending in MT? Maybe that's easier. I don't know. But anyway, one was aware that dreamt was such a word, but it didn't come to mind. If it didn't come to mind, then one may well have denied that there were six-letter words of that type. Or one may have, depending on what your views are about how likely it is that you'll think of things, if it presented with a problem of a certain type. So someone might say, look, you believed all along that dreamt was a six-letter word ending in MT. But then when you were asked, are there such words, you didn't say yes. So you believed that there were, you believed, if you like, FA, but you didn't believe there exists an XFX. How is that possible? How could that be rational? Well, inference is a mental act. I infer there exists an XFX from my belief at FA only if that belief occurs to me. But it may not occur to me. I believe lots of things that don't occur to me. Plato has this analogy in the Meno, I think, that Powers refers to. My beliefs are like birds flying around in my heads, and I call to them, and sometimes they come and sometimes they don't. But it's not a failure of rationality to not answer yes, there are such words, when you can't think of one. That's the rational thing to do. So here's a model of how one can believe A without believing B, though aware that A implies B. The truth makers that come to mind for A enjoy a credibility advantage over the false makers that come to mind for A, that salient truth makers for B do not enjoy over salient false makers for B. So in the six-letter words case, no truth makers come to mind at all when you're asked, are there six-letter words, blah, blah, blah. Hence, none with a credibility advantage. Whereas if you're asked whether you're presented with dreamt is a six-letter word ending in MT, truth makers for that come to mind pretty quickly, namely the fact itself. It's like, you know, the fact that there's that word there in the sentence. I mean, importantly here, it's not just that you recognize that there were such words because here you've encountered it in the sentence. That could have happened. It's that plus your reaction that, oh yeah, I already knew that. That jogged my memory, which I'm just taking at face value. In the preface case, where B is, allowed no errors into my book, false makers with a credibility advantage do come to mind when I'm asked whether I allowed errors into my book. I mean, I can think of all kinds of ways in which errors could have arisen. But there's no reason why any particular sentence in the book should fail, or why the book should contain further claims besides the ones I just checked exhausted its content. So it seems to me that in this case, you have a genuine sort of rational dilemma. And that's okay, that can happen. You're pulled two ways. And you know, depending on the case, you might want to resolve it one way, or you might want to resolve it in another. You could stare at the sentences again and say, you know, I couldn't have made an error with disastrous consequences because look at these are the sentences. They're 1 = 1, 2 = 2, 3 = 3. They're clearly all true. So, summing up, philosophical paradoxes and puzzles are apt to turn on changes of subject matter. Sometimes the premises seem true because they are true about their intended subject matter, but not their actual one. The world is cruel. It forced a subject matter on the sentences, which isn't the one that we wanted them to have. 2, sometimes the conclusion follows when addressed to one subject matter, but it's paradoxical only when it's addressed to another subject matter. That's what I was saying roughly about the Raven paradox. Sometimes the conclusion is harder to know because we don't know our way around its subject matter. That's the dogmatism paradox. That's In that case, it was its positive subject matter, its truth makers. Signs of a conclusion isn't known because we're less well defended against its false makers. That's what I said about the preface paradox. Sometimes a conclusion is not believed, even though it follows logically, and we know that it follows logically, because false makers come to mind that are more plausible than any coming to mind for the premise. That's omniscience in the preface paradox. Or plausible truth makers do not come to mind as quickly for the conclusion as for the premises. That's, again, the omniscience paradox and the paradox of being a six-letter word. That's pretty much all I have. Thank you. That should say the end, but there. Thank you.